All right, and we are back on stage and back to talk about gold policy. हम gold exchange के बारे में बात कर चुके हैं, but gold policy उससे भी ज़्यादा important है, because हर चीज़, चाहे वो export है, import है, jewellery है, exchange है, gold board है, सभी कुछ इस gold policy के अंदर आएगा. Mr. मेहता, आपसे यहाँ पर शुरुआत करते हैं. Of course, हमने gold policy की भी बात यहाँ पर पिछले एक दो सालों में करी है, और जैसे कि commerce ministry की तरफ से statements भी आए हैं कि March ending तक हम काफी कुछ इसके ऊपर सुन पाएंगे. आप क्या कहेंगे, कहाँ तक हम शायद यहाँ पर खड़े हैं, क्या एक इम्पोर्टेंट चीज है जो आप इस पॉलिसी में देखना चाहेंगे?
देखिए, जो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट बात जो यूनियन बजट 2018 में फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर ने कही थी, उन्होंने ये कहा था कि हमें गोल्ड पॉलिसी बनानी है जिसमें गोल्ड को एसेट क्लास बनाना है. गोल्ड को एसेट क्लास जो बनाने की बात है, वो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट बात है. गोल्ड यदि एसेट क्लास बनता है तो ये उसी तरह की एक प्रॉपर्टी हो जाएगी जैसे आपका रियल एस्टेट होता है, आपके व्हीकल्स होते हैं, आपके शेयर्स और इक्विटीज और बॉन्ड्स होते हैं. तो गोल्ड भी अब एक एसेट क्लास तरफ बढ़ने के लिए जा रहा है. तो इट्स अ कंप्लीट यू टर्न बाय द गवर्नमेंट कि जो पिछले साल तक जिस गुड्स को डीमेरिट गुड्स कह रहे थे, अब उस गुड्स को एसेट क्लास बनाना चाहते हैं. तो ये मेरे ख्याल से इंडस्ट्री के लिए सबसे बड़ा पॉजिटिव है, और मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि यदि सारे एसोसिएशन आज इस मंच के ऊपर बैठे हैं, यदि इसके इम्प्लीमेंटेशन फ्रेमवर्क पे यदि काम करें, तो गोल्ड डेफिनेटली एसेट क्लास बनेगा.
आई थिंक विदाउट डिले हमें मनोज जी के पास सबसे पहले यहाँ पर जाना चाहिए. मनोज जी, ऑफ कोर्स यहाँ पर स्टेटमेंट्स है कॉमर्स मिनिस्ट्री की तरफ से, फाइनेंस मिनिस्ट्री की तरफ से, कि मार्च एंडिंग तक शायद हम यहाँ पर कुछ सुन पाएंगे गोल्ड पॉलिसी को लेकर. उसके ऊपर क्या क्लैरिटी है, कितना काम यहाँ पर हो रहा है? ऑफ कोर्स हम इसके ऊपर बातें करते रहे हैं, लेकिन बहुत ज्यादा थियोरीज और हाइपोथेसिस यहाँ पर ज्यादा है, एंड एग्जैक्टली क्या है वो आपसे जानना चाहेंगे.
इसमें आप अगर देखें तो कोई हाइपोथेसिस नहीं है, कोई मिस्ट्री नहीं
है. हाइपोथेसिस हम कर रहे हैं.
कोई मिस्ट्री नहीं है. उसका कारण ये है कि बड़ी ट्रांसपेरेंटली नीति आयोग, विच हैड अ मैंडेट टू कोऑर्डिनेट विद all ministries, consulted every stakeholder. Anybody who had to do with this subject was consulted. So after that due consultation, suggestions and everything, a comprehensive gold policy is being framed. So obviously there is no mystery around it. Yes, there would be a challenge when it comes to implementing those. But one big achievement that has happened is that gold as a subject was being looked at from different perspectives by different stakeholders. For some, it was a raw material for the industry. For some, it was a financial instrument. For some, it was something to do with current account deficit. So everybody actually tried to look at gold and its growth prospects from their perspective point of view. Nobody had the big picture. So this comprehensive gold policy on which Niti Aayog has worked and which has been finalized has been a very big achievement in that sense. But yes, like every policy, there is something short term, there is something medium term, and something long term. So we cannot be ambitious to implement everything overnight. So we will have to be patient on a few things for a longer time period. And there are low hanging fruits definitely, which are recommendations from the various stakeholders, which I think, as you said, from say end of March or April onwards, probably they'll be ready for implementation. And as I said, we will institutionalize everything. This consultation has brought everybody together. So now Department of Commerce would institutionalize this arrangement so that it is not just one time activity. We are not saying, okay, we came together, we made a report and that's the end of it. Now this togetherness would and merging of ideas would be even more important when we are implementing it. Sure. So we are on the right track, and we will definitely try to bring about some confidence in the stakeholders by implementing the short-term and medium-term recommendations at the earliest possible.
मनोज जी, अगेन यू नो, एक चीज जो हम सभी इस गवर्नमेंट को थम्स अप देते हैं वो ये है कि सब स्टेकहोल्डर्स की बात सुनी जाती है, और एक बार जब कोई पॉलिसी डिवाइस भी की जाती है तो उसे चेंज भी करते हैं डिपेंडिंग ऑन द फीडबैक जो हम यहाँ से लेते हैं. सो डिपेंडिंग ऑन व्हाट यू सेड, हम ये मान के चलें कि जब गोल्ड पॉलिसी आएगी तो वो डिफरेंट फेजेस में आएगी, जैसे आपने कहा शॉर्ट टर्म, मीडियम टर्म, लॉन्ग टर्म होगा, या फेजेस में इम्प्लीमेंट की जाएगी.
policy is a framework, and basically the objective of the policy is very clear: to let this industry transform itself, the gold industry, which includes the gold market and everything, and reach its true potential. So there are various aspects to it, as we have been discussing. There was a panel discussion on gold spot exchanges. There is a talk of making it an asset class, and there are so many aspects to it. So obviously, I would say policy is self-evolving thing. We cannot say today the policy that we had 10 years back probably needs a review today. Similarly, what we are calling as policy today may be reviewed after a few years again. So policy is a self-evolving dynamic thing. But as I said, when we have a framework now, the recommendations are the policy indicatives. They've said this is to be done if you want to transform this market. So I would say at this point of time, we have frozen the policy framework that we require, maybe for next 3 years to work upon. And it will have elements of something which can be done today, something which can be done in 6 months' time, something which will require 2 to 3 years' time. So therefore, implementation will be in phases. But policy framework that has come up is something which has been frozen today and is a directive for all of us to move forward for next 3 years' time or so.
So, you know what, we will take views from all the associations and heads from here, and of course, we will have you answer them all. So, I'm starting with you first. There is a framework which is ready now. What do you think is going to be a big challenge and an opportunity that can arise out of the gold policy as we see it now?
I think the big challenge will always remain CAD, because at the end of the day, we should not forget that gold monetization scheme hasn't worked in a big way, and we still are reliant on imports, which is 90%. But as Rajesh mentioned, now out of that 90%, now at least one third comes through in domestic refining now, in a sense. Still, CAD is a problem. Right now, it is not, but as an if at all, God forbid, if it comes back again, then we may have to probably, what happens to this policy recommendations? What happens to, will it be suspended for a while? Those are still issues for us. I don't think we should just forget that. So that's a big challenge from our point of view, because it's still important. GM is not working. This, in terms of opportunities, I think we have always maintained, yes, it is an imported commodity. There is no doubt about it. But it has such a significance. It is creating so much employment. I mean, should we probably work on the strengths that it brings? And have we been able to leverage the strengths? So that's what we would consider as the, the opportunity. I don't think we have leveraged the opportunity, because we are more focused on imports, overwhelmingly focused on imports, for the right reasons or wrong reasons. We don't want to get into that. But it has actually led us not to leverage the strengths. That's what I would call the opportunity, which is what this report is bringing out.
Sabyasachi, coming to you, and GJPC, of course, has been a major part of this. We've seen some concerns in the last couple of months as well. What are you expecting out of this gold policy? We have talked about everything under the sun that should be pulled under this policy. What would you say should be the major point here?
See, GJPC is very consistent in its approach. Basically, what is problem, what at least we had envisaged the problem long time back, that, you know, the gold is being controlled by too many regulators, you know. Like RBI has a different objective, Commerce Ministry has a different objective. Inside Commerce Ministry, you have DGFT, then DEA, Department of Economic Affairs. So everybody has different objectives for this. Now those objectives has to come together, because in the end of the day, for India, let's say as a country, policy, why government will be involved into coming up with a policy? The policy means you have to create value. Because in the end of the day, we are importing gold. That means India is investing into gold, basically, in the end of the day. If you invest into gold, say, so what will come out of that? What creation of value? If you look, at least we have a prime minister who have at least understood that in meeting after meeting, he has told that the basic thing is to create the value. Inside, domestically also create the value. Today, you are, what value you are creating? How much value? See, today, gold as a commodity, you are only trading. Or you create jewelry. And then in jewelry, if you go for high-end jewelry, if that value is not there down the line, for the people whom the government is interested, the employment of people, their income levels, etc., that will not increase. So, and in exports also. So then that foreign exchange earning. So everywhere down the line, if the policy, whatever policy will come, that will be for creation of this value down the line across the sector. What, as a Gem and Jewelry Export Council, we have always told is that there should be a single regulator for this. you see how telecom regulator has, you know, expanded the industry, how the aviation regulator has expanded the industry. So there should be a single regulator. Otherwise, in government, you know, there is always a turf war that this government, let's say the Department of Economic Affairs will tell something, and let's say the DGFT will tell something. All this will continue till the single regulator will come. I think what, you know, Manoj ji today has announced, you know, which is a very important thing, that the gold board, which is also one of the largest demand or biggest demands of our German Jewelry Council, that bring everything under gold board, so they will have a holistic picture of the whole thing, and they come out with the regulation, empower them, take out the powers from other parts of the government and empower them to do the entire thing. Now, how the formation of the gold board, etc., of course the Commerce Ministry is looking, because they are the most interested party, because the entire import-export happens to them. The gold, if it is imported totally from outside, let's say 700 to 800 tons of gold, so they are the largest interested party in the whole ballgame in our understanding. So we hope that this gold board comes into picture and they take a holistic picture, and as a regulator they bring this policy forward and take it forward.
Manoj ji, aapne of course gold board ki yahan par baat to ki, aur gold board ki baat yahan pe kafi samay se chal bhi rahi hai. Koi nahi chahta ki hum bahut sare bosses ko yahan par report kare, aur yahan to bosses alag alag jagah baithte hain aur alag alag cheeze dekhte hain. To agar hum gold board ki baat karte hain, kya uske kya layers mein, kya uski representations hongi, kis tarah se usko dekha ja raha hai?
Gold board jo conceptualize kiya gaya hai usme ek to element hai प्रॉपर रिप्रेजेंटेशन का, सो दैट जो जो भी इसमें कोई रोल रखते हैं, जैसे आरबीआई की बात आती है, फिनेंस मिनिस्ट्री की बात आती है, इसी तरीके से रेवेन्यू डिपार्टमेंट की बात आती है, इवन जब हम स्टैंडर्ड्स की बात करते हैं तो बीआईएस की बात आती है, कंज्यूमर अफेयर्स मिनिस्ट्री की बात आती है, कॉमर्स मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ कोर्स इंडस्ट्री को रिप्रेजेंट करती है, तो कॉमर्स इंडस्ट्री को ही इसको ड्राइव करना है. तो एक तो प्रॉपर रिप्रेजेंटेशन है, तो इन सब का रिप्रेजेंटेशन उसमें होना चाहिए. दूसरा ये है कि बोर्ड के पास क्या पावर्स होंगी कोई चीज इंप्लीमेंट करने के लिए. नाउ दैट विल डेफिनेटली, दैट्स अ डिफिकल्ट पार्ट. रिप्रेजेंटेशन इज द इजियर पार्ट. द डिफिकल्ट पार्ट इज दैट हाउ डज इट लीड टू अ चेंज थ्रू अ लेजिस्लेशन, थ्रू सर्टेन पावर्स और एम्पावरमेंट बाय द गवर्नमेंट, बिकॉज डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन भी बहुत जरूरी. अगर गोल्ड बोर्ड के होने के बावजूद हर डिसीजन के लिए अलग अलग मिनिस्ट्रीज में गवर्नमेंट में जाना पड़ेगा, तो गोल्ड बोर्ड की अहमियत खत्म हो जाती है. सो इसलिए वो भी है, और वो एम्पावरमेंट जो एक एस्पेक्ट है जिसमें लेजिस्लेशन की भी जरूरत है, इसमें कुछ और एस्पेक्ट्स भी हैं, वो एस्पेक्ट जो है उस पर काम शुरू हुआ है. एंड वो जब एक बार उस पर कंसेंसस बन जाती है, स्पेशली विद द फाइनेंस मिनिस्ट्री, देन ऑब्वियसली वी विल बी एबल टू गिव अ बोर्ड टू द इंडस्ट्री, to everybody, to all stakeholders, which will be able to resolve many issues, from day-to-day issues to I would say
structural and long-term.
Structural and long-term, except for some very big changes, everything else I think can be done in a decentralized manner through a gold board. Therefore, this thought process, which has been now running, and it is part of the recommendations of the comprehensive report by Niti Aayog, has a good role to play. But एक चीज इसमें फिर भी आती है कि इसको कैसे आप इंश्योर करेंगे कि जो दूसरे रेगुलेटर्स हैं, जैसे सेबी एक रेगुलेटर है, इसी तरीके से आरबीआई खुद में एक रेगुलेटर है, हालांकि उसका डायरेक्ट इसमें रोल नहीं है, बट फिनेंशियल इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स के लिए आरबीआई थ्रू बैंक्स इज अ रेगुलेटर. हाउ डू दे एक्चुअली एम्पावर दिस बोर्ड टू एक्ट ऑन देयर बिहाफ? सो दिस इज वॉट इज अ डिस्कशन दैट हैज नाउ स्टार्टेड. Our honorable minister, the commerce and industries minister, is taking a lot of interest, and he wants to take a lead in forming this board and giving it to all stakeholders, so that most of their issues get solved, and thus jagah jane ke bajaye they know that they are approaching one body jahan pe unke representative bhi hain. So access bhi badhegi, effectiveness bhi badhegi, aur mere khayal se that will be a game changer for this industry.
Can I ask a question actually to secretary? So what would be the governance structure in terms of reporting relationships of this gold board with respect to the RBI, for instance, or with respect to SEBI? What would be?
Yes, I can explain it to you like this. Suppose decision X comes to the board. the board meets, calls a meeting of a board. In that meeting, a representative of RBI at a fairly senior level is also there. Now, unless this is something which has to do with a very difficult situation that RBI has to face, probably this is a matter which can be discussed there. And now in that discussion, we have representatives from the industry and other stakeholders. So a decision is taken which can be implemented through the board. And since board has been empowered to take the decision, so now what, otherwise it will happen today also. Maybe if this representation goes to RBI, RBI calls for a meeting, it holds a stakeholder, it submits its recommendations to Finance Ministry, Finance Ministry again does some consultation, then probably something changes. So now we have a board which is fully represented and is empowered to take decision. And the chairman of the board is also empowered to take day-to-day decisions which can be ratified by the board, which will be minor changes or minor adaptability which is required to address various issues. Now, suppose DGFT is also part of the board. The customs people are also part of the board. The RBI people are also part of the board. Don't you think many issues which are today related to exports, imports, ease of doing business, they can be resolved in one forum? So that kind of easy governance is something, and more or less it will be decentralized also, because going to government definitely takes more time. So, and especially when you have to approach many ministries. So therefore, if you are not approaching the ministries, you are approaching a body which is well represented by all, and a decision can be taken in meeting instead of writing letters to interministerial letters, going through a long process of decision making, and then coming to conclusion, probably something can be done through a board meeting. So that is the kind of future that we look. This board mechanism has worked in many other areas, but in this area, probably it would be something new, and therefore I call it as a game changer.
Surely would be a game changer. Just before you keep that mic down, I just want to know, what is the timeline before we see this gold board actually come up?
That's a very difficult question, because see, government is not very good in following timelines, and the pressure on government to have something like this has started emanating, because once this thought process came through, and everybody, I have not seen any stakeholder saying no, something like this is counterproductive or something. So the pressure is high. The only thing is that, as was mentioned by Mr. Som Sundaram and even Mr. Sabyasachi, the issue is gold for us is a foreign commodity. We get it, we do a value addition, we again
and sir, we hoard it.
And we hoard it. So obviously it has a lot to do with our current account deficit. It has a lot to do with our foreign exchange reserves. And some people even say that the rupee-dollar parity is hugely affected because of the huge amount of imports that we do. So those are the things which tell us that, okay, are we just seeing it as a commodity, or we are seeing the value addition part of it also and the other aspects of it also. So therefore, time frame is something which I don't think at this moment I can. But since the process has been set rolling, so in government one thing is said, that if something is started, it definitely reaches to a conclusion today or tomorrow.
Sir, I take your point that government is very pressure. I am assuming this panel will pressurize you, media will also do it, and there is a room full of people. So if there is need for any more pressure, I think it's on. Ma'am, what's your sense really? Because of course, we have talked about gold board here, but gold policy in that sense, what are you looking at on what it should really be achieving in the market?
I think any gold policy needs to cover four or five broad aspects. The first is the entire business around gold, which means you're looking at the import of gold, you're looking at the production of gold, you're looking at the manufacturing aspect. So that I'm broadly terming as the business of gold. And one of the first things that this gold policy should be looking at is the entire aspect of Make in India of gold. And if you look at the Make in India revised policy and priority sectors, gems and jewelry is not part of it, which is quite surprising. And I know that's one of the recommendations that will hopefully go through the Niti Aayog report. But that element, we need to focus on that, creating a brand and helping with the market. The second aspect that any gold policy needs to look at is also from the consumer protection angle. So where can you go? How can a consumer register a complaint redressal, and from a consumer protection angle? The third is to look at it from the financialization of gold, which means how do we look at it from the point of view of making sure that the above stock grounds of gold enter the formal financial system, and all subsequent purchases of gold are also part of the financial system. Now, this can happen through new products that come in, this can happen through existing products which are, well, revamped of course, but you'd still have to work. So this is these are three or four of the broad aspects. The gold board is maybe one of the most significant. The regulatory framework is the last one, and in that there are two or three things that Pehle India Foundation has been actively recommending. One has been the gold board, largely for two reasons. First, because as Mr. Dwivedi said, you need a single point of regulation instead of the way it's been kind of cut up. And the second is, ideally, the gold board would be the one to regulate your gold spot exchange, and not necessarily SEBI. So notwithstanding what the previous panel said, SEBI may not be the best choice, because again, commodities will have to be looked at as a whole. And because we don't have a carve out for precious metals, I don't think SEBI will be very comfortable regulating a spot market for vegetables or any agri commodity. So keeping that in mind, probably the gold board would be best suited to do that. Apart from that, the gold policy should also look at what other kind of players will enter. So a vaulting system is very important and also a prerequisite. So I think what was discussed in the previous session, saying the supporting infrastructure that needs to be built to facilitate even a gold exchange, all of this will have to be taken into account. A bullion bank, for example, how do you get participants onto it? So this would be comprehensive. The Niti Aayog report has dealt with various facets of this, and hopefully that will give us a great starting point. But it will be one that evolves, and I don't think it will come in by March end, because I think that's cutting it too fine, and quite frankly, it's not going to get done. I think to draft a proper policy, if you want to take in, you know, stakeholder views, look at international experiences, look at all of that, I would say March next year is a more realistic timeline for expecting at least the first draft of a policy. And I think that's fair. I don't think we should move in a hurried manner. It has to be deliberated, discussed, and at least, you know, everyone needs to be consulted. So March next year is my sense.
I remember we've been talking about this for the last 2 years, so do not say it's a hurried manner. I think it's
creating the policy in itself. See, it's taken 5 years ago when I used to work with FICCI, was when we came out with, you know, with WGC art report. The first report that the government actually took up and then ran with everything was titled Why India Needs a Gold Policy. That was literally 5 years hence they've done it. Now, we've convinced them as to why it's important, and in that period, there were many other recommendations that they've run with. But now that you're creating a policy, and it's the most important document that will kind of shape how we address gold in the next coming, you know, next couple of years, or 5 years, 10 years, whichever way, it should be a thought-through process.
And you need a lot of patience, and his point is well taken, because we are waiting for the hallmarking rules and regulations to come in on 1st of Jan, and we are still waiting for them. Your point, really. You want to say something?
Yeah. So, just to pick up on the point of the gold board, never mind, doesn't matter. One of the things that I just want to, and I would request Secretary to also give us a little more insight on that, is ultimately regulating the governance structure. The governance structure of the regulator is going to be key to whether it works or not. One has heard some other thoughts also on this, so I'm sharing those with you. So, for example, a subsidiary of the RBI is another possibility that could be used to regulate this, including the spot exchange and so on. Another thought is equivalent of a Securities and Exchange Board of India, which is probably what the Gold Board is, what you're alluding to. However, that is somewhat different in the way that you kind of laid out to us just now. So that's one part of the equation, how that's going to work. The second part, I just want to pick up on both the points which have been made. My worry is the transaction cost of the coordination between the ministries to make it happen. There is the Department of Financial Services, there is the Department of Economic Affairs, there is the Department of Commerce, there is the Department of Consumer Affairs, there is SEBI, there is RBI. So that's already six, I think I've counted. And there are probably a couple more over there. Now, the Gold Working Group and the Niti Aayog group that was put together, I thought were very interesting efforts to kind of bring together that coordination. Having said that, I'm a little uncertain, you know, and I'm also going to take the risk of being a little unpopular on the some nuances of the efforts which have gone there, simply because at some level certain kinds of skill sets are not available in certain places, and so there is a certain level of apprehension within the government also on taking on board some things. So all of those make me a little apprehensive on the timelines. Having said that, I'm actually quite hopeful that we might actually have the first policy statement within this calendar year. I wouldn't actually go till next March. I would say within this calendar year, for lots of reasons, because one is working with the Ministry of Finance on various aspects. So my sense is something will happen. But it would be really interesting to see how that coordination plays out, because without that coordination, I think any policy which comes about is going to fall flat.
I'll be very brief. I think we require a separate session on Gold Board. But yes, in fact, this is the biggest milestone that we have covered, is getting everybody on board. So what you said, the earlier way was people would write letters and send files, interministerial consultation would happen, and based on that something should be recommended. But now with Niti Aayog's intervention, all have been on board, and that coordination cost and effort has been saved. So that is one big milestone that has been achieved. The second is that the recommendations are very futuristic. So obviously they will take time to implement. For example, I can give an instance that how banks can play a bigger role. There is a full set of recommendations on that. Now, obviously that has to be run through by RBI on each and every aspect and come up with proper guidelines how banks can expand themselves to play a bigger role in the bullion market, in the gold market. So obviously those directives itself are quite useful. Because, and this committee was headed by the principal advisor to the Prime Minister. So he's heading it, and from Niti Aayog, which has the full support of the Prime Minister's office, I think it is at the highest level that these directives are being drafted. Now, as far as whether it is this next March or this March, I can say that let's not get lost into that. Let's be positive that we have moved a few steps forward. And I don't see any inclination of moving backwards. So therefore, when we are moving forward and moving in the right direction, I think we should feel good about it.
Sir, agle March se pehle ek aur budget aa jayega. So, you know, just saying that we should perhaps do it in this calendar year. Rahul, let's come to you then. And while, of course, hum bahut cheeze yahan par discuss kar rahe hain, lekin gold as an asset class, gold as a financial instrument, monetization, गवर्नमेंट के फेवरेट वर्ड्स रहे हैं, आपको लगता है कि ये परहैप्स गोल्ड पॉलिसी भी जब निकल के आएगी तो इस चीजों के ऊपर यहाँ पर काफी ज्यादा स्ट्रेस रह सकता है?
सी, इन प्रेजेंट डेट ओनली कम्युनिकेशंस व्हाट वी रिसीव फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट इज रेगुलेशंस. आप ये कर सकते हैं और ये नहीं कर सकते. देयर इज नो डॉक्यूमेंट व्हिच सेज व्हाट इज द लॉन्ग टर्म विजन, व्हाट इज इट व्हाट इंडस्ट्री इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू डू. व्हाट हैपेंस, फॉर एग्जांपल आई विल गिव अ बुलियन डीलर्स एग्जांपल, 2080 ही गॉट अ रेगुलेशन कि आप बहुत सोना इंपोर्ट नहीं कर सकते. सो ही रियलाइज्ड प्रीमियम वेंट अप. सो वट ही कुड अंडरस्टैंड कि जो पैसे मैं कमाता था 100 किलो बेच के, मुझे 2 किलो बेच के मिलने, उसने कमाए और बात खत्म. ही डिडंट रियलाइज व्हाई गवर्नमेंट डिड इट एंड व्हाट इज गवर्नमेंट एक्सपेक्टिंग मी टू डू आउट ऑफ इट. आज गवर्नमेंट को इंपोर्ट बहुत नहीं करना है तो मुझसे क्या एक्सपेक्टेशन है. सम जूलर हु इज एन एक्सपोर्टर, ही रियलाइज गवर्नमेंट ने 10% ड्यूटी कर दी, माई बिजनेस इज गेटिंग अफेक्टेड. सो नाउ सर हैज पीपल क्यूड अप एवरी डे कि मुझे 10% देना पड़ता है हर एक्सपोर्ट से पहले, माई मार्जिन इज स्लैश. सो एवरीबडी सीज देयर पार्ट ऑफ रेगुलेशन एज द गवर्नमेंट पॉलिसी, which is not actually the policy, which is an 11th hour decision to solve some problem at the end. So gold policy, I mean, my perception is it should not be a document which is regulatory. It should be a document giving the intention. And as this Niti Aayog report has just come in, so it talks of various intentions what people have from various departments as well as various stakeholders. So it's a good time to talk a macro level discussion. The document which is similar is foreign trade policy. So Department of Commerce and Ministry of and DGFT gives out this document which gives a macro intention ki export badhana intention hai, aise aise aap export badha sakte hain, jiske custom notification aap dekhte rahiye, parantu objective is this. Something similar on a macro level which tells people at large what do you expect from refiners, what do you expect from, I mean, once you talk of traders, we want them to come on an exchange. So now people are understanding government wants to build an exchange, all business should be on exchange, but there is no document. Just because we are discussing exchanges, that is why we are feeling that we want exchange should come up, but there is no document ultimately which talks of all the facets. So my expectation is should be only a policy document. And whenever I had interaction with sir, I feel whatever he talks is policy only. Macro kya hona chahiye? Probably documenting that will solve a lot of issues. He never talks micro, he always talks macro. Usko kagaz pe likhte hain, utna hi bahut ho jayega.
Sure. Let me put something in perspective. Yesterday, RBI's decision to ban all your LCs and LOUs, unilateral decision. But look at how that's going to import. Notwithstanding what happened, it's a retrospective regulation which is not really going to do anything as far as what has happened. B, it is now going to drive up cost of import, which means that even if you're importing a lesser value, you're going to be driving up the value of that, which means it'll have an impact on CAD, which means you're going to go into the same problems again. I think when you have a gold policy, when you have a gold board, invariably what you're trying to push for is a kind of framework, a system, a philosophy where you say no regulator or a policymaker who's involved in any kind of decision making around this commodity will make unilateral decisions without consulting anybody else. I think even if that comes in, you'll see a sea change in terms of how the sector in itself operates.
I think that really brings us back to gold board yet again.
I'll just add something on what Nirma pointed out. Today, everyone over here is discussing that notification which came yesterday. So we know what that notification is talking, legally speaking. But we don't know what is the intention of government. We know $2 billion ka nuksan ho gaya, ye regulation aa gaya. Ab kai log keh rahe hain ki usme BG allowed hai, bank guarantee allowed hai. Matlab Bharat se koi importer videsh mein bank guarantee deta hai bank ke through, to wo allowed hai. So ultimately as a commercial person, I feel there is no change. It's absolutely same. So I'm still wondering what was the intention. So if there's a policy document in place, I can understand what was the intention. Whether trade finance lines of banks are put under check. LOU में लिखा नहीं होता था कि क्या सामान इंपोर्ट हुआ और क्या फाइनेंस हो रहा है. प्रोबेबली इन अ बैंक गारंटी विच इज मोर डिटेल्ड डॉक्यूमेंट इज विद व्हाट गवर्नमेंट इज इंटेंडिंग. तो जो आदमी विदेश से फाइनेंस कर रहा है इंडियन इंपोर्ट ट्रांजैक्शन, ही वांट्स दैट एवरीथिंग शुड बी नोन टू मी एंड दैट इज प्रोबेबली द इंटेंशन. सो इंटेंशन शुड नॉट बी प्रोबेबल, शुड बी श्योर.
जस्ट टू रिस्पोंड टू दैट, आई थिंक आस्किंग फॉर जस्ट अ पॉलिसी स्टेटमेंट और अ डॉक्यूमेंट विदाउट एनी रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस इज प्रोबेबली नॉट गोना हैपन. A statement of intention is one thing, but all industries, regard to any industry, not just gold, any industry functions within a regulatory and a legal framework. And there's no reason why that's not going to happen for this industry, whether it is palatable or not, for the simple reason the role of the government and of the regulators are to put in place the rules of the game. The rules of the game are not intentions. They are rules of the game.
Sir, I'm not saying that regulation should not be in place. Regulation has to be there. There is no doubt. But regulation being interpreted as policy is what is happening on ground and is not great. For example, 2080 policy. So notification said, "Aaj se ye ho gaya. Ye kitne din rahega? Kyun aisa rahega? Nobody knows." Everybody felt ki ab main hamesha 4% margin banaunga bullion bank se khareed ke aur aage bechkar. Which was a temporary affair. Had people knew that it's only a 4-5 month story, once our forex reserves mop up, I mean that very moment they brought FCNR deposit scheme and some good amount of forex deposits came in and the government had a normal issue, so they took it back. That's the macro thing. But ek aam aadmi ko wo baat samajh nahi aati hai. Wo sirf wo notification WhatsApp pe ghoomta rehta hai aur uske interpretation nikalte rehte hain aur usko interpretation policy ke form mein hi mana jata hai ki intention hi government ka ye hai ki ab hum acha paisa kamayenge. Aap ek bullion dealer ka sochiye jo 1-1 kilo bechkar 1 lakh कमा रहा था, उसको एक साल बाद बंद हो गया. उसको लगता है मैं तो इतना अच्छा पैसा कमा रहा था, गवर्नमेंट ने मेरे अगेंस्ट क्यों काम किया. मेरी 1 लाख रुपए किलो कमाई थी, 50 लाख का मैं कमा लेता था महीने में 50 किलो बेच के, मुझे काम भी कम करना है और कमाई भी ज्यादा है. देन ही फेल्ट इन 2014 what sense prevailed that my income has been reduced.
I understand that, of course, but we are slightly deviating away from our subject really. We understand, yes, the government policies, regulations, sudden steps and the intention and the impact that we see in the market, of course, is quite wide there. Mr. Jose, let's get you back on the conversation as well. What is your sense, coming back to the gold policy really, what do you think it needs to do to improve the kind of market that we are in right now?
I represent the gold refining industry and the bullion manufacturing segment. In fact, in India, we have around 15 world-class refineries licensed by the BIS, and they have an installed capacity of around 1,500 tons. But unfortunately, for various policies, for want of various policy support, as well as the main problem of feedstock, our feedstock is dore. We have a huge shortage of availability of dore. We are at the moment producing around 400-300 tons from dore, which is a big positive step. If you look at the 2012, 5 years down the line, in 2012 we were producing 5 tons of gold from dore. Now it has gone up to 250 tons, catering to around 40% of the country's requirement. So we are in a position, this industry, as Mr. Gosla has rightly pointed out, this industry has got the potential and the technical capability and the capacity also to manufacture around 800 to 900 tons, provided the necessary feedstock is available. Our feedstock is coming from 4 main sources. One is, you know, the domestic production. At the moment, the domestic production is hardly less than, domestic production, I mean, mining and from secondary sources like copper, slimes and all that, less than 10 tons. And recently, we have identified some mining sources in Rajasthan. It may take another 5 years time to get some physical gold out of the Rajasthan new mines coming up. Unfortunately, the mining is, the licensing is with the, in the domain of the state governments. So if the policy gives some thought to the domestic mining and the domestic geographical explorations and all these things, which is now in the domain of the state governments, we should be able to produce around 100 tons of gold over a 5 to 10 year period. So 100 tons, that would be there. So we have around 25,000 tons of what you call idle gold deposits in the households. If we can target 1% over a period of 2 to 3 years time, we should be able to do that. Because out of the 25,000 tons, around 20 to 30% is in the form of gold, bullion bars and all this idling with the households. If we can properly incentivize them by giving some 2 to 3% return, we should be able to mobilize around 250 tons. So that is another 250 tons. Then from, if you get, we are looking, we have been taking up with the government to give some policy support for fine-tuning our dore imports, which are all revenue neutral. There is no revenue impact. We are not asking for any concessional duty, but documentation and all that.
Or a document of intent. Here also a document intent has been already put in by the Niti Aayog, which should form up into the gold policy with the enabling infrastructure in the country to have that, because the business already exists in the country. There is all these components, whatever we are talking about, they are already there. Only they have to be brought into a formalized apparatus so that it is brought inside the economy of the country. That is what we want. So that is what it should be done in by the gold policy.
So from India Gold Policy Center at IIM Ahmedabad, we have only one objective, seeing the abysmal failure of the gold monetization scheme and probably every other scheme relating to gold. Our hope and prayer is that we are able to help in formulating a policy that is able to take on board all stakeholders and is able to get the detailing right. I think one point that Rahul mentioned a little while ago was about the micro aspect of it. And you know, God or the devil, whichever you believe in, is in the details. And that's what we need to get right. And that is where I think there's many a slip betwixt the cup and the lip, especially when there are coordination issues between many different branches of the government. And whatever policy regulatory authority is formed, ultimately will succeed or fail based on that detailing, which captures the coordination issues very well across, you know, financialization versus trade versus bullion, spot exchange versus exports versus jewelry making, vaulting. All of those are linked. So that has to be captured well in the details.
मेरा हमेशा से ये मानना है कि जो गोल्ड मोनेटाइजेशन स्कीम है उस स्कीम को चेंज करने की जरूरत है, उस स्कीम को ट्वीक करने की जरूरत है। आज की तारीख में यदि मुझे, मेरे पास पैसा है तो मैं पैसा बैंक में जमा कर सकता हूँ, मैं पैसा किसी म्यूचुअल फंड में दे सकता हूँ। बैंक एक सरकारी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है, म्यूचुअल फंड एक प्राइवेट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है। तो यदि मेरे पास गोल्ड है तो क्यों मुझे आप जबरदस्ती बैंक में भेजना चाहते हैं गोल्ड मोनेटाइजेशन अकाउंट खुलाने के लिए? क्यों किसी प्राइवेट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को आप ये अथॉरिटी नहीं देते हैं? आपने म्यूचुअल फंड में, जैसे HDFC म्यूचुअल फंड है, रिलायंस म्यूचुअल फंड है, बहुत सारे म्यूचुअल फंड है, उनको यदि पैसे कलेक्ट करने की आपने अथॉरिटी देकर रखी है तो आप ऐसी प्राइवेट कंपनीज बना दीजिए जिनको गोल्ड कलेक्ट करने की अथॉरिटी हो और आपकी गोल्ड मोनेटाइजेशन स्कीम सक्सेसफुल हो जाएगी। आज की तारीख में मेरे हिसाब से ये स्कीम सिर्फ इसलिए सक्सेस नहीं है क्योंकि बैंक उसके ऊपर ज्यादा काम नहीं करना चाहता। जब आप प्राइवेट कंपनियों को लाएंगे तो वो गोल्ड मोनेटाइजेशन में ज्यादा काम करेगी, वो अपने आप गोल्ड कलेक्ट करेगी और सरकार की जो मंशा है वो पूरी हो जाएगी। ये मेरे हिसाब से पॉलिसी के अंदर ध्यान देने की जरूरत है।
As a conclusion from my side, I would say there are 5 objectives of the gold policy and we have to achieve that. Obviously, first through a broad framework, then through detailing, and then through implementation. So all those steps are important. The first is that the gold policy should be able to actually get out the gold which is lying idle. So that is something. We talk of tons and tons of gold which is lying idle. I think that should come out. How do we do that? There are instruments for that, and so that is first objective. The second is, if I have to use gold as a saving instrument, I should use it in the, not in a physical form, I should do it in the demat form, and therefore this clear distinction should come in, and therefore the compulsion of buying and keeping gold in physical form should be reduced. So that is the second objective that should come. The third is that value addition in gold manufacturing should be achieved so that we don't get a blame of importing gold and then exporting it for nothing. So therefore the value addition and using that value addition for increasing exports, for increasing our gross domestic production is the third objective. Fourth objective is employment generation. As I said, this is one of the champion sectors which is employment intensive. There are people working. In fact, one aspect of the policy has to focus on the work environment of the karigars, which is pathetic. It needs huge improvement. The new generation is refusing to work in this sector. They are going in for other areas of work. So again, the policy initiative has to address this aspect as well. And the last aspect is to actually create an ecosystem through whatever instruments, like we are talking of spot exchanges and others, to create an ease of doing business when it comes to any part of the gold, whether it is manufacturing, whether it is trading, whether it is exporting, importing, or whatever it is. So these 5 objectives have to be achieved, and we have been all working on it. So we hope that the first stage of getting recommendations and intentions right is the first thing, which has been achieved to some extent. Then detailing is the second thing which we are working on, and then obviously the biggest challenge would be the implementation, which will definitely require institutional arrangements as well as cooperation between all stakeholders to effectively implement it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you've actually summarized it all. Haven't left much for me to say, but as you said, yeah, we're still waiting for the documentation, and the implementation part is going to be the next one. But just to make it slightly lighter, you know, that getting a policy on, I don't know how you're going to monetize or financialize the gold, because mujhe yaad hai ki humne bahut pehle ek aise hi ek सर्वे किया था कि अगर आपको एक अच्छी इंस्ट्रूमेंट, फाइनेंशियल इंस्ट्रूमेंट मिलता है तो आप अपना गोल्ड लेके आएंगे क्या, तो बहुत ही कम लोगों ने अपना हाथ यहाँ पर ऊपर किया था। एंड द सेकंड क्वेश्चन मैंने पूछा था कि आपकी वाइफ करेंगी क्या, तो किसी ने हाथ ऊपर नहीं किया था। सो आई थिंक दैट इज गोइंग टू बी स्लाइटली अ बिट ऑफ अ चैलेंज इवन नाउ। लोग शायद नया सोना यहाँ पर खरीद नहीं रहे, लेकिन अपने घर का सोना भी बाहर आके आपको देंगे। आई थिंक वी आर टोटली ऑन विद यू ऑन दैट। थैंक यू सो मच। थैंक यू सो मच पैनल। थैंक यू सो मच ऑडियंस एज वेल फॉर लिसनिंग टू अस। थैंक्स।
Hello, check. Thank you very much to our entire panel. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them a huge round of applause once again while they get together for their photograph. I'd like to invite Mr. Ashish Pethe, Governing Board Director, IBJA, Mr. Kamal Singhania and Mr. Keyur Shah to join us on stage to felicitate our panelists and moderator. Okay, we'd like to felicitate Mr. Manoj Dwivedi, Joint Secretary, Department of Commerce, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. Mr. P.R. Somasundaram, Managing Director, World Gold Council. Mr. Sabyasachi Ray, Senior Executive Director, Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council. Mr. Jatin Chheda, he's not here, okay, fine. Mr. Rahul Gupta. Mr. Rahul Gupta. Mr. Arvind Sai. Ms. Nirupama Soundarajan. Mr. Surendra Mehta. Mr. James Jones. James Jones is over, okay, fine. And Ms. Manisha Gupta. Okay, we'll have a group photograph with our presenters and our panelists and our moderator.